So, I have spent the last few evenings reading Kelly Corrigan's new book, Glitter and Glue. As many of you know, I split my working hours between Ann Arbor and Traverse City, and this week I am in Traverse City, staying at the beautiful Park Place Hotel. If you were at happy hour on Tuesday or Wednesday, you may have noticed me enjoying a glass of wine and reading Glitter and Glue. Now, on Tuesday evening, I quickly realized that reading this book in a public setting was probably not the best idea, but I did it again on Wednesday night. It wasn't the best idea because I laughed out loud, not heartily, but still out loud. I laughed out loud as I read lines like, "I was haunted by the image of a product that power cleaned dirty vaginas." Yeah, I said that. And I discreetly wiped away tears when I read lines like, "And it occurs to me that maybe the reason my mother was so exhausted all the time wasn't because she was doing so much, but because she was feeling so much." Over the last few weeks, I have watched several of Kelly Corrigan's videos that are featured on her website and her YouTube channel. Now, maybe I'm sentimental, and maybe it's because I'm a mom with young children to whom every day I try to be a great parent, but instead every day I seem to say something or do something that I think is going to mess them up for the rest of their lives. But her words, her messages in her videos and in her books resonate with me. She looks at simple everyday moments and ordinary people and makes them meaningful and significant, even though they are just everyday moments and ordinary people. I love that because life is filled with moments and people like these, and they are important and significant. Tonight, Kelly Corrigan will sit on this stage with guest host and my friend, Rich Folley. Prior to coming to the National Writer Series, I worked with Rich at Borders for several years. He is a passionate, down-to-earth, genuine, and intelligent guy. He also happens to be the founder and CEO of BiblioStar TV, which, among other things, means that he gets to have conversations with really amazing authors a whole lot of the time. Kelly Corrigan's Glitter and Glue is currently number 2 on the New York Times bestseller list. Now, if all of us buy enough books tonight, we, Traverse City, just might be responsible for moving her from number 2 to number 1. And I think she would like that. So please welcome to the stage my friend Rich Folley and the author who has been making me laugh and cry and be more accepting of my own mother and frankly my mother-in-law. But most importantly, about making me more accepting of myself as a mom. Rich Folley and Kelly Corrigan.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jill, thanks.
Hi.
So lovely. Thanks. Here, I'll put you right over here.
Okay. I brought presents, but we'll get to that. We're not going to rush into the present part.
You want to find a place for them so you don't
have
to. Well, welcome to the Polar Vortex portion of your book tour.
Oh, bless you so much for coming out. I never would have done it if the shoe was on the other foot. I would be at home, bra off, remote control in hand, hot tea, done for the night. So you're very, very nice to come out.
We actually thought about that for about a very short period of time.
Yeah.
That being the night right there.
I thought about doing it myself tonight. Just saying, I don't know. I live in California. This is much too cold.
You know, I think I want to talk about Glitter and Glue because it's your mom's turn. But before we do that, I really think we need to set the table. And you have 3 books that you've put out that sort of, there's an arc to them. And I think the best thing is to first talk a little bit about where it all started with The Middle Place and then move into Lift. And we'll get to Glitter and Glue.
Okay.
We'll get to Mom.
I trust you. So I was 36 years old. I had 2 kids in diapers, and I had moved all the way from Philadelphia, where I was raised, to California, where I was making my own life. And I thought I was very grown up and had crossed off everything on the list. And then I got a phone call that I had a runaway case of stage 3 breast cancer, and I'd be in chemotherapy in a week. And I dialed 610-527-2255, which is my parents' number. And they came running. And over the course of that fall, what I thought was really the first adult experience of my life, which is a fairly charmed life, I found that actually I was reverting to childhood. And my parents were caring for me in a way that they hadn't since I was very young. And I was eating cookies for breakfast and living in my pajamas and getting presents for no reason at all, which is the sure sign of childhood. And And then on the heels of my last chemotherapy, my mom called and said, I don't know how to tell you this, but your father had some blood in his urine and he went to check it out. And apparently he's got cancer and he's going to be in chemotherapy now, so we can't come for Christmas. And I remember thinking, like, this is adulthood, this moment. That if I have to live in the world without the one person who has made it a safe and good place for me, that must define what it means to be a grown-up. And so that, to me, was fodder to work through. And so I worked through it on the page, and it was right around the time of self-publishing. So I had this belief that even if no one ever paid attention to me in New York, I could still have it printed and bound, and I could hand it to him before he died. And I could finally say, we call my dad Greeny, and I'm not allowed to say why on a microphone, but you can find the answer on page 278. I could finally say to Greeny, like, this is what it's meant for me to be your kid, you know? And so that book was called The Middle Place, which referred to that time, you know, that sliver of time, actually, when you are both someone's parent, but you are still sort of identifying as someone's child. And that's really where I found myself.
And Greeny is a character that is larger than life. Anybody who's read your books, they feel like they know this person. And of course he was the subject of your first book because he just presents himself as that kind of person. He's just loud and in the world and in your face. And one of those guys is lovable. And it's hard to resist him when you're around him. I've been lucky enough to meet him before. And he loved having that book written about him, I'm sure.
He did. But, you know, the interesting thing about him as a father is that he was never hard to impress. So it was like, getting a book on the bestseller list, doing a cartwheel, fantastic. Like, it's all so great, Lovey. You know, did you make these cookies? God, Lovey, that's incredible. Did you write this book? Unbelievable. You know, it's, and I think that as a parent, you know, the title of Glitter and Glue comes from this expression of my mother's, your father's the glitter, but I'm the glue. It takes both, Kelly. And I think it's really true, and he had this relationship with all of us, I have two older brothers, that was really, you know, pure cheerleader. And he never missed an opportunity to go crazy over something we did, you know, or anyone. I mean, if he met you, he'd be like, God, look at that tie, Rich Folly, I love it. Did you do your own hair? Look at that hair, Lovey. You know, like, I mean, he'd just have something nice to say about everybody here. And meanwhile, my mother would be sitting back going, George, isn't it time to go? It is minus 16 degrees here. Let's get the hell out of here.
Yeah, your voices we're going to talk about because they're classic. And I know in my family, I do voices for my mother and father and my
Can
wife's
Can you do them for
father.
Us? Do your mom?
I don't do them nearly as well as you, but I will tell you that they don't always love it when I do the voices.
Yeah.
But you say of this about your mom, right in the prologue, it was in the first couple paragraphs of the book, that says she looked at motherhood less as a joy to be relished than as a job to be done, serious work with serious repercussions. And you say that you left childhood assuming our way of being with each other, adversarial but functional, was as it should be. That couldn't be more opposite than what you just described from your dad, obviously.
Yeah. And you know, it's interesting to me to think about, I mean, this book, writing this book and talking about it with others now, for the last month or so, has caused me to look at the way our generation approaches motherhood in particular. It's all I can speak to. And the way my mother's generation did it. And for her, it really was work. It was a job. It wasn't supposed to be touchy-feely or fun or emotionally satisfying. It wasn't like a relationship the way I'm approaching it. And I sometimes wonder if maybe I'm making a mistake to sort of crave that intimacy and that constant conversation with my children, because that puts you in a vulnerable position of wanting them to like you in addition to loving you, which may or may not be possible with teenagers. And I think that her willingness to be unpopular in her own home was actually quite admirable. And the older I get and the more fierce my children become, the more I admire her willingness to hold her ground, even though we were just so ugly about it. I mean, I must have said to her, like, I wish Allison's mom was my mom, like 15 times. I mean, if Georgia said that to me now, it would just cut me in two.
Yeah, I mean, you're at a stage now where you look at your own children and you obviously have the ability to think of how you were And I know when my parents as a teenager wouldn't let me go to Fort Lauderdale with all the rest of the high school kids going to Fort Lauderdale.
Uh-huh, to study.
And I just said, I will never do that to my kids. They are going to get to go to Fort Lauderdale, right, and they're going to be able to do that.
Great. Right. I'm going to give them my credit card and my car.
There's no way they're going to any of those places. I've seen too many YouTube videos. They're not going.
Right. Well, you know what's so funny is in the middle place, there's this little section called the Guess Jeans Fight of 1984, which is this total fantastic brawl that my mom and I got over a pair of Guess jeans, which cost $52, and Dara was just beyond absurd. And I was a fool for the marketing and trying to fit in. And, you know, and she just doesn't do that. She doesn't do it in her own life. I mean, she has literally been wearing the same elastic waistband pants from Macy's 17 years and counting. I mean, on and on and on they go. And so now I just had the Lululemon fight of 2014. Do you know what Lululemons are?
Yep.
So they cost $72 for a pair of exercise, supposedly like workout pants. And women my age wear them because they like lift your booty up. So Georgia, who's 12 and whose booty is perfect, wants a pair of Lululemons. I said, you don't need them. They're not for you. And she said, everyone in my class has Lululemons. And there I was. You know, it was like the record was playing again. And I had gone from being Little Orphan Annie to Miss Hannigan.
You know, that crossover period, I mean, it's funny because when you're young, you just don't see it. And you're never going to. And there's no hope, really. I mean, I think
there's
the most.
If there's one message that we can get across to you tonight, there's no hope.
You won't see it until you're later. But that crossover period for you, it really took you having to leave your mother and leave with that adversarial but functional relationship. You left to go see the world and to become more interesting, as you put it in the book. And it wasn't until you were gone and away from that person that you began to really sort of figure it out. And I think that sort of distance does that so often. But for you, you had to go like clear across the world.
I think I went like literally to the mile as far as I could get from her. I mean, it was 10,000 miles. I went down to Australia and I had, you know, like a fanny pack full of American Express traveler's checks, which I'm sure nobody uses anymore. And an around the world ticket, which was on paper. So if I had lost it, don't know what would have happened. And my little Lonely Planet guide. And I thought, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to have my odyssey and I'm going to become somebody with just ripping yarns to tell. And then I'll write those in a book and then I'll become a writer, which was always the dream. And it's so funny now because this is my third book and they're all about family. I had everything, a little bit like Wizard of Oz, you know, I always had everything I needed. But I went over there and I was starting to run a little low on funds and it seemed like I better get a job or I'd be back on my mother's doorstep in like a month, which was not the plan.
Insert like mom's voice right there.
Yeah, exactly. I told you so. And so I wanted to get a job as a waitress or a bartender or something like fun and sexy with lots of guys. And I was 24, I was very high on the agenda. And they weren't available, and so in the Help Wanted ads in the Sydney Morning Herald, there was an ads for nannies. So I took this job with this super rich family with this beautiful house high up on a hill looking down on the Sydney Opera House, and they even had an indoor pool. And I thought, like, uh-huh, like totally nailed it. And then the second day she asked me to scrub her pool tiles, and I said, you know, is that like for extra money or is that... like part of what I've signed up for, because it doesn't seem like I'm really with the kids if I'm scrubbing the pool tiles. And then the next day she said, I think you're a little too unionized and we think you should move on. So then I went back to the Sydney Morning Herald and there was this ad that had been there the previous week that I noticed with a little lump in my throat that it was a widower who was looking for a live-in nanny for his two kids, 5 and 7. And I thought, I'll just call and if he sounds nice. And then he sounded lovely and so I said, I'll just go meet him. And then the next day I moved in. And over the course of those 5 months, I thought of my mother, you know, all the time. I mean, she was just playing in my head like an old movie, partially because I had never seen anybody do the job that I was doing except for her. So I was sort of naturally referring and deferring to her. And partially because the kids were really interested in her. So the letters would come to the mailbox, you know, the little blue papery aerograms. And they probably don't exist anymore. And they would hover around me to see, you know, what would a mother write to a kid in a letter. And they wanted to trade pictures, which meant that I had to get my mother to put a picture in an envelope and send it across the seas to us. So we waited and waited and waited for the picture to come. And then the third reason that she was on my mind was so fluky, and that was that she's a great reader. She reads like a book a week. And she's always been bugging me about this one called My Antonia by Willa Cather. And, you know, it was sometimes assigned in school, so the combination of it being academic reading and a suggestion of my mother's meant that I would probably never, ever crack the spine. And then there it was on their bookshelf, and I had all these hours to fill while they were in their little preschool and school. And so I read it, and the strange thing was that it's so nostalgic and romantic. And I have never thought of my mother in those terms. I mean, I think of my mother, this can be on the radio, but only in Michigan, right?
That's right.
Do you watch Downton Abbey? So I could kind of think of my mom like Maggie Smith. Like, she's super
opinionated.
Maggie Smith is phenomenal. There are many people that are as loyal to my mother as we are as fans to Maggie Smith. Like, she's just, you know, not one for small talk, not one for big show of emotion, not super into, like, a lot of physical contact or introspection. But also kind of fiercely devoted and always there. You know, she's right there for her family. So the fact that she was sort of secretly loving this book, you know, about a girl running across a prairie in the sunlight, was really surprising to me, and it caused me to ask the million-dollar question that I think all kids come to ask about their parents is, so why did Dad pick you? Right?
Yeah.
Which is, I think, the beginning of who are you other than my mother? Like, who were you before motherhood did whatever it's done to you? And who are you when we're not around? And are you happy with your life? And is this what you wanted? And,
yeah,
you know, all those questions.
You talk about in the book, there's a section in the book where you were working at your mom's real estate office, and everybody came up to you and was telling you how funny she was and she was the life of the office. And that she was made everybody laugh. And I could see the befuddlement in your face from here while I was reading the book. You're like, what are you talking about? That woman? No way.
I mean, I kept saying, like, I'm Mary Corrigan's daughter. And they're like, we know. We love her. She's a riot. It was like, really? And then while I was working there, I was in the break room getting a Diet Dr. Pepsi and a Twix, which was like my afternoon fix. And I overheard her telling a joke. And I thought, I have never in my life heard you tell a joke. I can't imagine that you're going to be able to pull this off. And, you know, I was just kind of cringing the way that maybe a parent would when their kid's, like, on a balance beam or something. Like, oh, this is not going to end well. So I'm back there, you know, just drinking my soda and listening. And she totally landed it. And yeah, she killed
it.
Everybody was laughing. Yeah. And then the joke was about, like, a woman having sex out of wedlock, which was also a little against type because I had spent, you know, 15 years, like, listening to how no good women ever have sex with anyone other than the man they marry, and that, you know, so I was just a little confused.
I think we've talked about this before. I mean, the when you peel away the layers, as you put it, of what motherhood has done to you, I mean, there's this other person under there that you don't know, that as a daughter you don't get to know until a lot later as you start to season your understanding of her with input from other people and pictures and photos and other life stories. But you just don't know that when you're a young kid fighting for your guest genes. There's no way.
And as her role as a mother recedes a little bit, you know, but she takes that job so seriously to this day, although she's trying to retire. So she said to me, this perfectly encapsulates my mother. So she's turning 75 in September. That's also something that we're not going to tell her, I said. And I said, Ma, what do you want for your birthday? You better tell me now, because everyone's going to start colluding behind your back about how we want to have a big party, which she never wants to have a big party. She wants to have a party for one, which is when she, like, takes off her bra, gets her library book, pours some inglenook over ice. So I said, tell me what you want so I can advocate for you with GT and Booker, my brothers, and my dad. And she said, do you know what I would like? If there is any problem that you or your brothers have, that there is something I could do about, I would like to know. And I thought, God, that's incredible. And then she said, and if there is any problem that you or your brothers have, that there is absolutely nothing that I can do to change, I would like to not know about it.
That's a wise woman.
I have been a mother for almost 50 years, and I am tired.
Yeah.
And I thought, I will give you that. Yeah. I will find a way to give you that.
That's a great thing.
Yeah.
I was lucky enough to meet your mom once, and the story is classic in that because Kelly told the story once about how when The Middle Place came out, her mother would go to the local stores, the local bookstore, and move all the books to the front of the store where people could find them, covering up other books and making sure that people could have them. And we went, and there, sure enough, she was there. She was in Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania, and we have cameras on her doing this exact
thing. You have to Google it.
She's a woman who loves her daughter so much, and yet, to your point, it was never something that she felt the need to overtly show as a child, but it was always so deep and steady.
Yeah, she's, you know, the traditional forms of expression don't work for her. So she doesn't want to say, I love you. She doesn't want to hug. Like, when I hug her for too long, she says, stop it. What are you doing? Are you dying? And then, of course, that just makes me hug her more, which I think is so funny. And then she gets all red. I mean, she has like a physiological reaction to being touched. But then this is the thing I'm trying to say about this kind of like fierce devotion underneath all that. And then, even then, you know, she did that almost every day for many, many, many weeks. And I always pictured, she used to put it right in front of Susie Orman's book was out right then, and it was on the bestseller list, so it's got a special placement in the store, and then she would stick The Middle Place like right in front of it. And then I always pictured Susie Orman's mom coming behind her and saying, who the hell is putting this on top of Susie's book? And then she'd put it by the Altoids and the People magazine, well, all the things she thought were high sellers. And then if I were to try to say to her, can I just say, Mom, like, you're just incredibly supportive. She'd, stop it. What are you talking? Stop it. Like, it would just make her so uncomfortable for me to try to give her credit for that kind of support.
Yeah, and you know, we talked about this a little bit too, in that your mom has become the glue for so long, but it also, by being the glue, it allows your dad the relaxation of knowing that that's covered. He can go out and be who he naturally
yes.
is, that Abulian self can come exploding out into the world because he doesn't necessarily have to cover that other stuff, that
right.
more serious side of parenting. As you now are a mother, and as you are sort of moving into that phase of yourself, in my house, whenever we sort of want to make a joke about my wife, we call her Grandma Nancy, who's her mother.
Oh.
And it strikes, you know, it cuts to the quick, you know, at our house. No, I'm not.
Yeah.
Even though it's, of course, a huge compliment. But now, as you've kind of, you know, becoming that mother that with a little bit more seasoning, what does it mean when Edward or somebody says, oh, that sounds like Mary Corrigan right
yeah.
there, not George Corrigan?
You know, it's funny. I used to think that my parents created each other, like because she put on the brakes, he put on the gas kind of thing. But I actually think, my father fell in love with her before she fell in love with him. And I think that he saw in her, he knew at a super deep intuitive level, this is the woman I need. Like this is gonna click, this thing's gonna click into place and together we're gonna be a great team. And I actually think my mom knew the same thing. My husband Edward always points out that she loves the Corrigans. So she's from a very quiet, introspective, introverted family that where children should be seen and not heard and preferably not seen. And my dad comes from this big, huge Irish Catholic family where people are laughing and crying and making these big toasts all the time. I mean, you can't go to dinner with them without seven people making a toast over nothing. He said, you know, your mom's really happy there. Like it's there's something that's released in her when she's on in Corrigan territory. So I think they recognized like their missing piece a little bit. Edward and I are much less extreme. We're much more similar as people. So I am alternating between glitter and glue all the time. However, As the full-time mom, although it certainly doesn't seem like it when I'm here with you in Michigan, but generally I'm the full-time parent and he's the part-time parent, there's just a whole set of stuff that I'm facing that he's not facing that's kind of all tidied up and clean by the time he gets home. And it's both metaphorically and literally clean by the time he gets home, you know?
Yeah.
So there's so much, I often think that from the minute he leaves in the morning, like the kitchen looks pretty put together, and so do we, and our lives seem pretty put together. And then we go through all this stuff while he's at work, and through afternoon, and through homework, and through dinner, and the dishes pile up, and then they go down, and I wipe the counter, and we put away the mail, and the recycling, and the compost, and the kids' backpacks, and he just misses the whole thing. You know, he doesn't know that all that happened.
Right.
And but I can definitely call him in to be the heavy in a way that, I mean, we just wouldn't have taken my dad seriously if he tried to come in and do the heavy thing. Oh, Kelly, I'm very disappointed in you. Like, I don't even think he could say those words. He'd be like, Lovey, your mom told me to come in here and tell me she's disappointed in you. So, like, just start crying at the count of three, okay? Like, it's just so not his nature. It wasn't like he actively was like, thank God Mary's here, I'm just gonna put my feet up. It's like his feet have been up since the day he was born. And he found somebody that could make it work. But you know, I've spent a lot of time with my parents alone recently because they live in Philadelphia in the house where I was raised and I live in California, but I have so much work now on the East Coast and readings and meetings in New York with the publisher and stuff. And so I get to be with them often without my kids, without my husband, without my brothers. And they are a great couple. They're about to celebrate 50 years, and they are a phenomenal, phenomenal couple. They're so well suited to each other. And I think they both really appreciate what the other brings. I mean, I'm sure it wasn't always like that, but they have smoothed it right on out. Like, they're gonna slide into home plate just smooth.
So did you, when you were younger, and you sort of, you know, there's always this, like, from the moment you're born, the parents are looking at pictures saying, who do they take after? Who do they look like? What do they act like?
Yeah.
And you start thinking about it as a child, I'm much more like my dad than my mom. And then, I mean, it's later that you sort of recognize the chemistry of who you are and that it's a real mix and that things sort of evolve over time. But when did you, when you were younger, you know, who did you associate with? And when did you start to see that shift, you know, as an adult?
You know, it was like, I'm my dad, and then it was like, oh my God, I'm starting to notice little things about my mother and me. I must redirect. And now it's like, I'm starting to notice more and more about my mother and me, and damn right. Like, that's my path. So, for instance, my mom loves to save. So it's another way of, so as a young person, I would say my mom is so cheap. And now I say my mom's really smart with money, and she loves to save. And I respect that, you know? She did all the investing. She worked through all the, like, 401ks, all of our college funds she set aside. She took that off the table. You know, she was the CFO of our family. And she, you know, made, you know, it's the loaves and the fishes. I mean, she took whatever he gave her, and she made it more. Mm-hmm. And I think that's so admirable. And I think that I understand, I have a regard for money that I don't always hear or find in my peers. And I always am having to joke that I'm so cheap, oh, I'm just like my mother, blah, blah, blah. But in my heart of hearts, I don't feel cheap. I feel like I don't value fancy clothes or a nice car and I do value other things. And so I put my money where I value things. And now I understand how sensitive money is. And that, you know, if you are into good wine, and then you want to be around other people who are into good wine because you don't want to feel guilty or weird or hesitant about your tastes. You know, it's like if I say, oh my God, you've got to go to Italy. You've never been to Italy. You got to go to Italy before you die. Then I want to be around other people who believe that it's so critical to go to Italy before you die. You know, like, we all are looking to be validated on these choices, whether we realize we're doing it or not. And she wasn't. She doesn't need that. She's not afraid to be different. And she never was afraid. So, like, she chews gum a lot, and she cracks her gum. And among my friends, it was like, oh, we're going to ride with Mrs. Corrigan today. She's going to... And, you know, this is mortifying for a child, right? Because there's, you just want to be exactly like everyone else. You don't want any little edges sticking out on any side. And now I just think it's great because she's driving this carpool like a total chauffeur. And if chewing gum makes her, makes the time pass a little faster, chew the gum, right? Like, it's her car. She's the one who's slaving away for all of us, and all us smart-ass kids are criticizing her for the way she chews her gum. I'd say chew away.
So we're sitting here in Michigan talking about your mom's gum chewing habits and what she does for, and you know how she raised you all. Like, what does she think about her life now in this book and between the covers of this book from your point of view, obviously? But what does she think about the fact that you're out there talking about her, that you were on the Today Show talking about her? Where
is
she?
You know, it's interesting. She loves the book. She thinks it's the best one yet. And she doesn't think that's funny. She thinks that's very objective, that it's just the best one. But she's typically very private, which means that she doesn't want to discuss these things with you. But again, she doesn't care what you all think of her. Like, she's very evolved in that way. You know, she's not... she doesn't have a lot of ego.
And does she get the idea that, like, your story is one that sort of we all glom onto because there's elements of your story that we can associate with and that we love because it feels similar to something we also know in our family, with someone we know, a parent, a daughter. And is she okay with that? I mean, and
she thinks it's very funny that anyone reads anything I write. Like, she's just, like, she's only been to one reading, and I forced it on her, and she, you know, she doesn't need to do that. She doesn't want people looking at her, like, all the time. And so she came to a reading, and she was ready to go. She's always ready to go, like, a half an hour before whatever it is over. You know, like, the bride walks down the aisle, she's like, let's get out of here. So she's at the reading, and you know, like a lot of people have come, and I want to sign their books because it's so awesome that there are still book buyers in America, and so I'm signing them, and she goes, "Let's wrap this up, Kevin." and then she goes, "Do you think they really want your signature? Or they just feel like they have to ask you for it." And I was like, "I don't know, Ma. I don't ask myself those kinds of questions."
So when did you decide that, like, memoir or this kind of, I mean, to me, it's really more storytelling. I mean, I know that memoir is what they attach to it,
yeah.
But to me, this is like you telling stories that make us laugh and then the next sentence make us cry and then you punch us in the gut and make us laugh again. But the idea of telling your own story, when did that dawn on you that as a writer, that's the way that's what you wanted to do, at least for now?
You know, I don't think I even knew about memoir as a category. But I mean, I was a kid that wrote in journals from seventh grade on, and I was an English major, and then I have a master's in English literature, and you know, this was what I loved. I loved reading books. I loved talking about books the most. I mean, what I think I really like is deep conversation, and I find that the world is sometimes lacking in that regard, but you can always find it in a book. Like, someone will really tell you something in a book, which is so ironic, right, that you would discuss something in the pages of a book that maybe you wouldn't be able to bring up eyeball to eyeball with someone. But I have always craved that, and I've always been slightly, insatiable about it. I can't quite get my fill in real life. And so that's why I liked English class, because I felt like everybody was revealing so much about themselves just by saying which character they liked and who they hated and how this ending totally bugged them. I thought, oh, I know exactly who you are now. Like, you just revealed your values. And I loved that. And so what I love about having these books out there is getting to tour with them and hearing people's stuff. And, you know, it's very satisfying for me to get a piece of other people. And I didn't know that memoir existed really, and I didn't really think that I was becoming a writer. I thought that I was writing this book to give to my dad, and I actually did self-publish it, and I did have it bound, and I did hand it to him in the kitchen of our home, and that's how he first came across the pages, and then it went somewhere from there. But to me, I would have always loved for it to be published, but my assumption was that's not going to happen to me. That's going to happen to somebody else, and I'm way too old to you know, switch gears now. I was a stay-at-home mom. I was almost 40, and, you know, I totally and completely given up on really anything happening for the rest of my life. I just thought, I'm a mom now, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be a mom. And that was, and then I have this secret second life, and I love it. I love it.
Well, I mean, it's funny because I laugh not only at and with your mother and at and with your father. I laugh at you, you're self-deprecating. You like to make fun of yourself. There's a funny line in the book about Edward, your husband, asking you, like, when did you become this person? And you say something about that you were like a show dog at the time when you were meeting Edward, and that doesn't count. Now you're like a, you know, unkempt bitch with like,
No, I said, I yelled at the girls, and he saw me, and he said, you know, when I first met you, you didn't drink coffee, and you were so mellow. And I was like, oh, honey, I was a dog in show. I was high stepping with my sparkly collar and my shiny hair. And 12 years and 2 puppies later, I'm an ungroomed bitch.
There you go. I'm so glad that that you said it, because it was wonderful. And but in these stories, I do find myself occasionally laughing at you. But the next sentence, though, you'll have me weeping with you. And I think anybody who reads these books, I mean, the roller coaster that I think you've sort of perfected. And we'll talk a little bit about memoir versus just storytelling in a minute. But that story arc and the roller coaster of really making us laugh in the very next sentence, you know, usually the end of a chapter, you know, just something that just gives you a shot to the gut where, you know, you're sort of wiping away something. And it's a talent that not many people have.
You know, my dad's a really good storyteller. And he's one of 6 kids. And we spent a lot of holidays where everyone was there. And there's like 20-something cousins on the Corrigan side. And, I mean, if you've met anyone named Corrigan, I'm sure we're related. And, you know, the Irish Catholic, not so good with the birth control. I'm one on the younger side of this whole giant set of cousins, and I just remember watching them and thinking, like, I want to be able to do that. You know, they could hold a room, they could tell a story top to bottom, they could make a toast top to bottom that had a little bit of everything in it. And I thought, of all the tricks that you could do, like a backflip, paint a painting, sing a song, like that's the thing I want to be able to do.
Yeah, and what's masterful is when you can tell the same story. In my family, we have a set of, there's always a new story that creeps in and some great ones, but the same story gets told over and over again. It gets better every year with seasoning.
Yeah,
and
you're not really allowed to do that in memoir. You got to keep it pretty close to the truth.
Well, that's what I want to say. I mean, unfortunately, like the James Fry incident with Million Little Pieces and other things sort of changed the idea of memoir. Storytelling is all about exaggeration adding layers to it, and maybe even telling a little white lie to make it just that much better based on the room.
Right.
I feel like we've lost a little bit of that in the memoir because we have to put it in a certain section in our bookstores. When just let it rip, I mean, come on,
spread the,
you know, like that's, it's all about sort of stretching the truth a little bit in a good story.
I've had to do some funny things. I have 2 older brothers. Let's call them Sam and Tim, just in case they hear this. So in this story, I said we had all gone to the same prom, and my mom was really nervous about me going to this prom. I was in 9th grade, so she put me in this horrible gunny sack dress and Princess Leia buns. And, you know, she pretty much worked it out so that nobody would want to touch me with a 10-foot pole. And nobody did. And so the next morning, I had this, like, Victorian collar that I could, like, touch with my ear. The next morning I heard her downstairs saying, like, wait, you know, did Kelly behave herself? And Tim said, Mom, Kelly's not a hose bag, which was a very common term in 1980, whatever. And so I showed the manuscript to Tim, and Tim was like, I don't want to have said that. And I was like, really? Like, as a 17-year-old, you don't want people to know that you use the term hose bag? And he's like, I'm a professional. Like, people are going to read this book. Like, I was like, all right. So I just switched it to Sam. So I said to Sam, Tim doesn't want me to say this, to attribute this quote to him. He's like, I love it. Put me down.
So is there other, it's like the brothers Corrigan, for instance, are there others in your family who are waiting for the next, like, you know, section of your writing? I mean, or are there people who are ducking and covering when you come around at Christmas time?
There's a little duck and cover. Like, there's definitely times, and I never thought this would happen, but there are definitely times where people, something will happen, and then they'll just turn to me and say, don't put that in a book. I think that I'm going to have to take a pause on memoir now because the most important people are not going to want me to write about them, and that's Georgia and Claire. So Georgia's 12, so her sense of humor has officially left the building, and everything is extremely important. And so I don't think I can, I mean, I don't think I could write about my life without writing about my kids, and I don't think I can write about my kids for a little while now.
So they were okay when you wrote Lift, which was your second book?
Or they've never read anything I've written. Who knows how this thing's going to unfold when they start actually opening the books. But they have not read anything.
Yeah, so your kids provide so much fodder, though, for some of your essays and some of your posts on Facebook and things like that. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine you not talking about them somehow. You're going to have to weave them into some fiction then.
Yeah, maybe. And then, of course, I'll get in trouble, and they'll say, that's me, and I'll say, it's not you, I made it up, and I'll still get in trouble anyway. So maybe I should just stick with it and write them as teenagers on the page. But, you know, it's funny because one of the stories in The Middle Place is me losing my virginity, and I was perfectly reasonable age, so I don't think I was all slutty or anything. But there's a couple lines in there that are, you know, just a touch graphic. And it really was just to make people laugh in the middle of what otherwise would have been a little bit of a tense passage. And I realized recently that, like, some boy in George's class might get their hand on the wrong sentence there, and that would really be awful. And so then I thought, I think maybe I should really insist that she looks at some stuff and just say, I just want you to know this exists so that you're not blindsided. That felt like the responsible thing to do. And then I said to Edward, I think I really want to get on this when I get home. I don't get home until March 5th. I've been away for almost a month. And I mean, I've seen them here and there, but they've had to come to me. And so he said, all right, you know, if you think that's the right thing to do. And then the next day he forwarded me a text from Amazon, and he said, did you download a copy of Glitter and Glue? And I said, I did not. And he said, well, somebody in this family did.
Ooh.
So I might end up being like 5 days too late on this whole thing. And if I am, it's your fault because I had to stay here. I had to show up tonight.
Your daughters are at that really sort of aware age now. When they were young and they were little and it was fun. And that's a wonderful time. They're totally oblivious to you talking about them and doing everything. Everything changes the second they think about boys or dates or whatever, or they start thinking about privacy. You talked a lot about how your mom was a regular sort of privacy invader. Now, what about you with your kids?
The only difference between me and my mom, so I completely concur with my mom that anything that I can find of theirs, I'm going to read and look at. I don't believe in any of the things I believed in when I was 12. That's all out the window. And I mean, one of the biggest fights I ever overheard my parents have was over my mom reading my journal. But the twist is that she wanted to, and she did, she wanted to ground me because I had made a list of every dirty word in my journal. And then she was going to ground me for a month for that. And my father said, you can't ground her. I mean, if you read her journal, then you can't ground her for something that was in there. And some of the dirty words were like hemorrhoid. Which, can you even imagine how I spelled it? Because I couldn't spell it right now with a gun to my head, but as a 12-year-old. So anyway, I did get grounded for that, which is ludicrous. And I don't think I would ground my kids. But I do, the only difference between me and my mom is that I'm totally open about that anything I find, any cell phone, any text or whatever, I have full access to, any email, you know. And I want you to know that.
And how do they handle that? Are they like rebelling against you? And have you had those battles that you
had? We had one bad thing happen where one of my children, let's call them Laura and Sarah, Laura opened an Instagram account and then, but did not tell me. And in fact, went one worse and said, we used to say to my friends, my mom loves Instagram, but she won't let me get an account. even while she had an account. Very bad, Laura.
Yeah, we're there in that my daughter has a Tumblr account that she didn't tell anybody about. It was very secret, and I found someone of her friends liked one of the posts, and somehow or another, it just sort of, she left it open, and there it was. And it's full of, like, teen angst and pictures of bands and other deep thoughts and, you know, things she's reblogged and things. And it was like this deep dive into my daughter's brain that I don't get. I'm more like the greenie in my house. I'm like, Nora, hey, yeah, everything's good. Let's make cookies.
Yeah.
No, there's a lot going on there.
I don't feel like I have very much access to my what's really going on in my kids' lives. And I can't believe that because they're only 10 and 12. But, you know, if I think back about seventh grade, like, what did my mother know about what was going on with me, about the fight with Lori Lindgren, or how I was now best friends with Allison Month and not Ann Nealis, and how I really had a crush on Charlie, but then Andy liked me, and, I mean, all that stuff that's, and it's so monumental to the person experiencing it. You know, it's the biggest feelings they've ever had. It's the most hurt they've ever been. It's the most crazy in love they've ever been. Even though we know that it's all so fleeting and passing and they laugh about it later, it doesn't matter because at that moment, it's everything. And I know that I don't know what's going on in their lives, and I hate it. I really do. I hated it. I find it heartbreaking. And I did not see it coming. I thought that that would be more 16, right around then, that I would just kind of lose, like, they would just pull all the way away and I would just have no visibility into their emotional life. And it's already here.
Yeah, the hardest thing is, you know, with the boys, it was different. And I don't know what it was like in the Corrigan household with your brothers or, but with the boys in my house, I mean, they just sort of blaze through and sort of bury some of their feelings. Whereas yeah, with the girls, it seems like there's just so much more, sort of meanness bubbling under the surface.
Well, we're much smarter, Rich. We're much
smarter. You're right.
There's that.
Yeah, I'm not arguing that point at all.
There's a lot of heartbreak in parenthood, you know, like, because basically, like, if you do it right, you're just forever saying goodbye. You know, it's just one goodbye after another. It's like, first you take them to preschool, and then they go to school all day long, and then you drop them off at camp, and then you take them to college, and then they float off into their own lives, and it's just, you're just watching them, like, you know, turn over into their next self over and over and over until they're gone. And yeah. I think that, like, I think about how often my husband's really close to his parents, and they have a wonderful nuclear family. And even still, they see him like, I don't know, 7 days a year, 10 days a year. 355 days they're on their own, and 10 days a year they get access to the boy that was the center of their life.
Yeah, I have to go call my mom right now.
Yeah.
It's been a few days.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, my mom is down in Florida, and I definitely, you know, I was like, oh, I got to call her. But it can be 2 or 3 weeks sometimes where I was just like,
that's not okay.
I say that. I just got to go call her.
That's a big change for me. I call all the time now. I call almost every day. And,
it,
you know, it's just nothing. It's just a little quickie, little touch. And sometimes something fun comes out of it. And sometimes it's just very routine. But, I mean, the other thing is you get older and you're just afraid. I mean, I'm afraid. I'm afraid they're going to die. I know they're going to die. I've heard that everyone does. And I've heard tell that sometimes it's just, and so I definitely don't erase my dad's, whatever his last voicemail is, I don't erase.
Your dad was, I saw one of your first stops in your book tour, your dad came out. It was for Glitter and Glue. I'm sure your mom didn't want to. But
I'll tell you, this is such a Glitter and Glue thing. So it's in Philadelphia, it's, you know, not this cold, but cold. And this snow, and they lose power. So I'm on the Today Show, and they have to go to a hotel to watch me on the Today Show. And then they go home, and I'm doing a reading that night. So Greenie says, Mayor, I'm going to get on Amtrak. I can get up there. There's a party beforehand. There's a dinner after. I'm going. And she says, well, somebody's got to stay here and make sure the pipes don't burst.
Oh my God.
That is glitter. That is glue.
That is a book in a nutshell.
I was like, you're so validating my whole concept.
You know, the one thing about glitter though is you appreciate glitter like on the spot. It's like insta appreciation when you're around that sort of robust personality. It's like so immediate and it's like, it's fun. And it just is like, you know, mainlining fun.
Yes, it is.
And then there's the glue. And it's just a slow and steady build to appreciation to the point where, you know, when they're older and sort of in their latter half or portions of their life, that's when you finally say, damn, that is a really great thing right there.
Oh, I feel so lucky that she's still alive, that I got to be with her this long to understand, to keep watching her and keep kind of apprehending all the parts of her. You know, if she had died before I had kids, like this mom did for those kids, I just would have had such a incomplete idea of who she was. I mean, you know, when we leave Philadelphia and the girls and I pull out, she stands in the driveway and she just has tears streaming down her face. Her whole face turns red. And she waves and waves and waves in her pajamas until we're long gone. I mean, I didn't even know she had tear ducts. Like, it's like, who is that person? It's like incredibly emotional and she can't wait to touch them. And
is she different with grandchildren than she is with
yes, you know? I think, although, you know, the truth is that for all I know, that's exactly how it was with me before I was 10. But then adolescence comes and that's really what I remember. And that's such a contentious, belligerent time that whatever was is completely obliterated.
You know, that makes me think about, and I'm careful when I tell stories about my family because I'm cognizant of the fact that it's completely colored by my perceptions of the time and what's happened, even in my sort of changing perceptions as I get older. And I think this is what happened and what was really going down in people's minds and emotions, but it totally may be this thing that I made up over time because that's what I saw or I thought I saw. And then it just becomes more concretely that as time goes on. But I'm not always sure. I don't always trust my own instincts anymore as I get older about what actually happened to my childhood.
I totally agree. And of course, you know, if the five people in my nuclear family were to tell the story of one event, we would all tell it differently. In every instance. And unless you've somehow agreed over time as you keep telling the story, and then what you're agreeing on is this is how we tell this story.
Right.
Not this is actually what happened.
Or if you write the books and you're the storyteller.
Yes, I beat them all to it now.
So you kind of own it.
I've established reality.
That's right. One of the things in the book too, the family, the Tanner family in Australia has a really big role in this book. I mean, they're the ones who sort of drew out your sort of appreciation for your mother and your relationship with this family so many years ago. What I was really heartbroken to read at the end is how they've just sort of, they're gone. You don't know where they are anymore.
I found them.
All of them.
I found the daughter.
So tell me, I want to know more.
Two nights ago in Chicago, I was leaving a reading and I got this email from the girl. And her, obviously I didn't use her real name and so I'm terrified now that I'm going to blurt it out. But I finally found them.
And she knew that was, and so she figured out that you'd written the book and that it's about.
No, I had sent, so I found, so this is the family that I nannied for. I couldn't locate them, which seems so insane because it's 2014 and we have things like Google and Facebook and LinkedIn, but still I couldn't find them. And so I hired a private investigator. That person gave me like 400 names. And so I tried, but it didn't have date of birth. And so it got very difficult to figure out how to even attack that list. So then I hired a second private investigator and she gave me 6 names of all the people who had this exact same name of this daughter, and she did have date of birth. And so there were 2 that stuck out to me. And so, but one of them had a middle name that was very telling. And so I wrote a letter and I found a picture from 1992 of the two of us and I put in the books and I sent it. And I sent it on like December 10th, and the people at the post office said it'll take 10 days. And I didn't hear anything. And I thought maybe she moved, maybe she wasn't the right person. And then just 2 nights ago in Chicago, I get this email, and
she sounds
so lovely, and she's married, and she sounds happy, and she was just lovely. So she knows. And then the next day, I got an email from my UK publisher who said, We've had significant interest in Australia in print, radio, and television, and we were wondering if you'd be willing to go. And I was like, you bet. Should I pack now? Should I just go right from Detroit? So maybe in my future, I will get to be in the same room with these kids. You know, it's a lifetime. I mean, you know anybody that you met when you were seven?
No.
That you did, that you,
not,
you
not
know,
that,
yeah, that moved
in another
away?
Country. And
yeah.
I mean, you know.
So, I mean, it will just be like meeting for the very first time.
But you're right about Facebook and other things sort of bringing people together. I mean, it's interesting that you have lost touch, you know, given that they sort of grew up in, you know, even more probably aware of some of these social media things. And I would love for you to find them again, because I want them to know that they have this effect on you. I mean, mm-hmm. at the time, it was very mm-hmm. difficult for them.
Yeah.
And it seems like...
I think they know now. Yeah.
That's great. That's great. So do you... this idea of travel, at the time when you were young, you said you wanted to go become an interesting person.
Yeah.
And you told us earlier how it was actually in your backyard the whole time, the sort of interest that you've found sort of...
Well, it's what I find interesting. You know, when I'm, like, walking with a friend or talking, I mean, I can get a certain level of interest in politics, a certain level of interest in business, and in particular people's businesses and their ideas. But really the juiciest thing for me is, like, tell me about your family. You know, who's your mother? What's the worst fight you ever had with your kid? You know, what do you and your husband do about finances? Like, I just want to know everything about how a family works together or doesn't work together. And those are the stories I'm always the most grateful when people share. So I did become interesting, but only in the way that we are all interesting.
Your stories about your mother always crack me up, and I sometimes feel guilty laughing at them, because especially like when you'll drop into The Voice or something, and I'm thinking, like, this is my grandmother. I mean, this is my mother. This is exactly the people that I know in my life, and it makes me laugh. I can tell you that when we tell those stories, sometimes we start to gang up a little bit as we're telling the mm-hmm. stories, because they've been told and they're good, and they're usually at my mom's expense or my wife's mother's expense, and it's hard to hold back sometimes to the point where it gets a little pointed. How does your mom handle, you know, that sort of playful side of being the glue person?
Oh, she's pretty good about it. She's a pretty good sense of humor, actually. I mean, in our family, they're always talking about the 11th commandment was thou shalt laugh at thyself. So, you know, She's not easily hurt. I mean, in some ways, she's not easily penetrated in any way. So she would never, you know, she would never, I mean, if she ever is hurt, she would never cop to it. She's pretty stoic.
There's a wonderful story in the book that as you're driving, your mom had done something to frustrate one of your friends, and he actually took to the graffiti wall as you're driving about, you know, brooms for sale at your house.
Yeah, the witch is having a sale. He spray painted it on the underpass on the way to our street. Brooms, $1, 168 Wooded Lane, our address.
And your mom, you said, didn't bat an eyelash. You know, she just said, yep, sticks and stones.
Oh, that's nice. And I was like, Mom, that's you. And she's like, I know. And I was mortified, but, you know, I had this feeling, I mean, the significance of that story for me was that it was the first time that I felt that, like, chemical anger, like, protective wrath that, you know, only mothers are said to possess, but, like, that mother bear, like, don't you touch my mother, you know, like, and then the other half of me was, like, mortified and wanted to jump out of the car and totally disown her. And that's adolescence, I think. You know, I think that the job of a tween and a teen is to separate. I mean, I think that's what's happening developmentally. And so they say it's the second rapprochement. Like, the first is the two-year-old who's like, you know, self, I can do it. And then, mommy! And then this happens all over again in adolescence, which is, I can do it. I don't need your help. You don't get it. And then, mom! And I feel that now. And I felt that in that moment of, like, oh my God, like, I never want to be seen with you again. And then, mommy. So I think it was kind of right on time developmentally.
You're I'm going to jump to a new topic, but your mom and your father.
There's only one topic, Rich.
Betty's
mother.
Your storytelling, though, has always been, I mean, you're telling it in so many different places now. You're writing articles, and you're doing it online, and you have these wonderful books. But you also have, like, really taken advantage of video. One of the things that became so well known was your video Transcending, which has 5 or 6 million views or something crazy, and was one of those early viral.
It was my mom. She just kept hitting it.
But it's one of those things where you're reading, and you know, you're reading from your book, and you're making people laugh. But video has become really important to you, and it's something that I think you do really well. Where do you see your storytelling craft going in the next few years?
I love the thing I like about YouTube and Medium, which are both like online places to tell your story, right? One's visual and one's in writing. Is I love. Disintermediating everything and just going straight to a reader. Like, that's sort of a thrill. And it's such a cool part of our culture now that everybody has access to everybody. And it's super motivating for me. So when I really want to say something, you know, when I really want to get something across, then I work so hard to write it, and then I kind of deliver it on my feet in front of a room full of people, but with a camera. And I don't know. I like just going right into somebody's house, you know, right into your laptop. Like, that's a very cool feeling. There's no, you know, go to a store and buy a book and get home and get down with it and whatever. It's just whoosh. I have two ideas for a next book. One is like a Michael Lewis Blindside type story that sort of landed in my lap. A friend of mine had a friend who had something really awful happen to them.
So nonfiction. Okay.
And then the other is this novel that I have been working on outlining, and then I have maybe 10,000 words, so a normal book might be 60,000 words. And I can't quite figure out how to tell it because I'm a first-person writer, and I'm a little bit a first-person reader. You know, like I think I gravitate toward books with narrators. And a little bit less to he said and she walked down the street and they. And but in order to tell this story correctly, I can't be one of the two main characters, I don't think, because it would be too easy to win over the sympathy of the reader. Mm-hmm. And that would kill the whole experience that I'm trying to deliver.
Yeah, this is a totally new discipline for you then.
Yeah, totally new.
Yeah.
So we'll see. When I go home, I'm going to interview that family. That the nonfiction story, and see how that feels. I mean, that's like journalism for me, and I don't know one thing about journalism, so I would just be totally intuiting my way through it, which I kind of like that. And somebody just passed out in the back. They finished their glass of wine.
sounds like it's a happy hour back there. Actually,
don't wake them up.
Well, that's actually probably a pretty good, you know, I think one of the things we want to make sure that you have time for is to read a passage for us the book. And then after that, we'll take questions from the audience. But I'd love it if you have something that you'd like to share with us from the book. We'd love to hear you read something.
Sure. So one of the, I'm just going to read it. I think you can just follow it. This has happened when I was in 10th grade. That Friday, Louise and I looked at each other as we headed to the locker room and decided to keep walking, past the showers, out through the smoking section, up the back hill, along the baseball field, across the street, through the giant double doors, into Sears, where apparel spread out before us like a field of corn stalks. We ran our hands along the shirts and sweaters, making snobbish noises to signal our superiority to these garments and the people who wore them. We went down to the basement, past the portrait studio, to the candy counter. I took a pack of gum and slid it into my pants pocket, just because. For kicks, Louise lifted a roll of Spree and slipped it into her oversized acid-wash jean jacket. I think acid-wash is coming back, by the way,
oh, yeah.
So just look out.
It's there.
I'm going to have to pay for acid-wash for my kids.
Yeah, and torn. And.
Oh, we went back to jewelry. Long gold chains hung in clusters by length. We tried on 3 or 4 of them, moving away from the counter to see ourselves in the full-length mirrors, making sure, I guess, that the necklaces worked with our wide whales and docksiders. I unclasped one of the hooks and dropped a chain into my book bag. I could hear my new necklace slide down my world history textbook along the cover I made from a brown Acme bag because Mama Pennywise didn't believe in buying glossy Go-Go's textbook covers from the school supplies store. Next, we went to hosiery, pulsing with anarchy. I saw my mom's standard pantyhose hanging on a rack. Suntan, control top, reinforced toe. Her birthday was in a week. I took 5 pairs. I could picture her face as she opened them. She wouldn't be happy I'd spent so much money on her, but she would love the practicality of the gift. Everyone needs a good supply of hose, Kelly.
Thank you. That was wonderful.
So the interesting thing about that story is that we got caught, and it was mortifying. And my friend Louise, almost said her real name, her mom came to pick her up, and my mom waited for like 45 minutes and just let me sit in there and stew, which was excellent mothering, I think. And then she picked me up, and she took me out into the car, and we got in the car, and she slammed the door, and I sat down, and she just went, what? Because I said, I took them for you. And she smacked me across the nose, and I instantly, my nose started bleeding, which I think was probably just because I had dry nose. But it was very dramatic. And so I remember when I was writing it and thinking, oh, this is such a waste of a writing session because there's no way she's going to let me publish this, and I'm not going to force it. So anyway, I sent her the book. She said I loved it. And I said, everything? Like even the Sears thing? And she said, absolutely. And I said, see, and I have a problem with me, you know, like with the little child abuse part. And she was like, absolutely, I'd do it again the exact same way.
Can you imagine how hard it was for her not to go pick you up and to wait and just sit there? Like...
Then the other thing about it is that's really significant to Glitter and Glue is that she said, I'm not going to tell your father about this. I don't think he can handle it. I really don't. And I remember thinking, oh, this is very big. You know, your love is different than his. Like, you want to save that so that it doesn't get all dirty and messy and shitty like ours has gotten. And you're going to let him still think that I'm a great kid, you know, even though you know that I'm morally defective.
Wow. She can hold that one over for a while.
Yeah, and now he knows.
Well, thank you for reading that. I would love to take some questions from the audience. And I think that there's probably some people out here who want to have...
So I have very exciting news for you. When I got to Traverse City, they gave me $100 in cash to spend in Traverse City. But it's so cold in Traverse City that I never left my room. And so I brought my $100 here, and I bought 5 books with it. And if you tell me your mother's name when you ask a question, I will make out a book to your mother or your daughter or a great mother in your life, and you can give it to her for Mother's Day. The other thing they gave me upon my arrival was this pie. And I just lost 30 pounds, so I'm not going to eat this pie. And so whoever came from the furthest away can have the pie. If you think you might be a contender, you let me. How far, where were you? Where?
Rochester, that's pretty good.
Rochester, New York.
That's quite fine.
You know what? I think we know who gets the pie, right? Where are you from? How far, where, what is that in another planet?
South Korea.
Oh my God.
Give the man a pie.
This is a cherry pie for you.
Come on down, get your cherry pie.
Thanks.
That really worked out. I thought everyone was going to be like, well, I came from 5th Street. I came from 6th Street.
All right, who has questions for Kelly?
Yeah.
My mother, Wendy, gave me a very loud voice, so.
Nice. We're going to write this to Wendy.
We're going to write it out to Wendy. So I just listened to Lyft today, driving to and from work, and I have to ask, Meg.
No guy yet.
Darn!
I know. So I wrote this book called Lift. It's little. It's out there. It's green. It's little and green. such a literary description of it. And it's about risk and parenthood, and it's just these three stories about sort of extraordinary situations that parents find themselves in. One of which is that my friend Meg was 40 years old, and she was trying to decide whether to let her fertility pass her by because she was having a little trouble finding Mr. Right, and she still hasn't found him. So if you know someone between the age of 40 and 60 who's single and lives anywhere near California, I would like the information, please.
I just am so proud of what you wrote about Kathy, and Erin will always hold a place in my heart after hearing your story.
Thank you so much. She's so special. So one of the stories I told is that my cousin Kathy, who's like my favorite cousin on the Corrigan side, she's 10 years older than I am, and her son Erin died in a car accident when he was 19. So I tell the story, and she's so great. She just stayed at our house for a week while I was on tour, and she's this very special person to every member of my family. So, yes. To Wendy.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Corey. Kelly, thank you very much for coming to the polar vortex back here.
Okay? Yeah.
And if you weren't Irish by heritage, you should have been, because you're a great storyteller.
I am.
You picked that up well. My mother, Evelyn, is 92. And she's one of those same people that you're talking about, the stalwart of the family that holds it all together. And I love the way you can put words and voices to our emotions that we all have. And you do such a great job. Thank you very much.
You're so welcome. This is for Evelyn.
Up here. Oh, okay, right here.
Hi. I might secretly read the book before I give it to my mom.
No, that is not how this works. Everyone needs their own copy. We cannot share the book. We cannot get the book from the library. There's a whole industry.
Well, I'm so sorry.
Tell me your mom's name.
Her name is Char, with a C-H. It's like share, but with an A.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And speaking of that, I have purchased the middle place for a couple of my friends who were diagnosed with breast cancer.
Oh.
So I did support the industry.
Okay, thank you. The industry thanks you.
Yes. But one of my favorite parts of the middle place, are we allowed to talk about that book right now?
Sure.
Is when you say, I don't know if you said it to your daughter, but you thought that you would always give her the best peach.
Uh-huh.
And I think about that because I'm a mom. And sometimes I think about that with my own kids, you know, like, I'm gonna really dig deep and give them the best peach today.
Yeah.
Because, you know, sometimes it's so, I'm kind of nervous. Sometimes it's so hard.
It is so,
so
hard.
I wondered, now that your
so
girls
hard.
Are tweens, would you still give them the best peach?
I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, it's my first abusive relationship, so I'm really, like, feeling my way through it. I mean, I've never been treated like this in my life. You would just break up with this person. Like, the disdain and the eye rolling and the rejection and then the come back and then the stay away. And it's definitely, it's incredible. I mean, it's just totally incredible to me that this is the way this is unfolding. I mean, I just thought I was going to be so good at it. I really thought I was going to kill it as a mom. And I have terrible problems with patience, and I have lost my temper too many times to count. And it's like the most everything. It's the most mad you've ever been. It's the most in love you've ever been. It's the most proud. It's the most stunned. It's the most amazed. It's the most connected. It's the most attached. It's the most ripping furious. You know, it's just a whole nother level of emotional
right up here. Yep, right here.
You can yell really loud if you want.
Scarf, middle.
Hey, Scarf. Come on, Scarf, do it.
Like a mink.
Hi, my mom's name is Chum.
Chum?
Chum.
How great.
Yeah, that's her nickname. But I was curious about the nitty-gritty of your writing style. How you, are you, when do you write? Are you a strong editor? Are you critical of your writing? Are you free?
Yeah.
I mean, you're a journaler, so I wonder how that affects your writing.
I don't have good habits.
No.
I don't have tremendous willpower or good habits. And I don't, my life doesn't stay the same year to year, year to year, because my, you know, I'm primarily a mother, and so as their schedules change, my schedule changes. And then I do have like this job, part-time job as a writer now. So like a big part of, I mean, I could spend a lot of time just trying to help the books that I've already written survive. And that's much easier, it turns out, than filling a page. One, I'm getting much better at editing. You know, what I started out naturally good at is knowing the difference between a nice sentence and a great sentence and like an awesome sentence. But I wasn't as good at seeing the forest through the trees kind of thing. Like, I couldn't understand the arc, or like, I like a little, I like a story, right? So you know now I'm writing like these 3, 4, 5 page chapters. And that I can do, I can write that little story. But then working out sequence and figuring out where the tensions are is more difficult. So I often get to a point where I have a list of stories that I like, and then I have like little drafts of stories that I like, but I'm not exactly sure why that story is important. And so I just have to sit it there for a long time, and I have to kind of go to bed with it on my mind and wake up with it on my mind until it like talks back a little bit and says, you know why this is important? Like, you know, the shoplifting story is a perfect example. So it's fun for me to tell that story. It's easy for me to write that story. I can remember it vividly. It's a super visual story, so I can take you into Sears and you can see the clothing. And so all that works. But I don't know what it's doing in this book until you remember the very end, which is that my mom didn't tell my dad. And then you have to go further than that. You say, well, now why is that important? And it's important because what I think she was saying in that moment is, we're going to have this kind of relationship, and you and your dad are going to have a different kind of relationship, and I'm not going to ruin that for you. I'm going to do you that favor. And then it belongs in this book versus some other book. So that's what I'm learning how to do, is like wait for each story to kind of reveal its meaning to me in the context of the larger project. But you know, I'll have to start all over with fiction. I mean, I'll have to figure it out all over again.
Do you laugh at your own stuff? Do you know when you've written something really funny?
Sometimes. And I definitely cry. Yeah. I definitely cry all the time when I'm writing. And I mean, not all the time. I'm just but I mean, anything that you've cried about that I've written, I cried when I was writing it. For sure.
Yes,
and
sir.
That feels so good. You know, that's a very cool feeling. It's like I'm actually feeling as I'm writing instead of being abstracted from it, which could ruin it.
It seems like someone that's so good at either memoir or storytelling, it almost seems too bad that you're going to fiction. Isn't there a way in a couple of years, some period of time, to come back and put it all together in terms of what it all meant, and maybe move the Sears thing to somewhere else and draw another conclusion to it? Because, I mean, people are reading for your take on family life.
Yeah.
And you've got a very clear vision of it.
Yeah.
And I'd hate to see you writing about, you know, a spy in Istanbul or something.
Oh, I'm deaf. Darn it. My whole idea, up in smoke.
My wife's name is Anne.
What is her name?
Anne, with an E.
Okay, good. I totally hear you. And I don't think that this is my last memoir by any stretch. I just think I'm going to have to just let things pile up a little bit and then and do something else in the meantime. Also, you've just put the fear of God in me that I'm not really going to be able to make the transition to fiction, and that you're not coming with me, and so maybe I'll retire. No, but I mean, I do have that fear because I know it from other people. You know, I'm often compared to Anne Lamott or Anna Quinlan, and then I overhear people in cafes saying, oh, I really like her nonfiction, but the novels, I mean, what's she trying to do? You know, and I think, oh my God, they're gonna say that, and then you're gonna say that. But I do think that I'll write again about family life and my family life. I mean, I actually have a whole set of things I'd like to write that I shared with my mother, and she said, why don't we do that after I die? So, like the minute she croaks, I've got like a book coming out the next week. Yeah. No, I have no sisters. I just have these two older brothers.
So your mom was your main influence,
female-wise? Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Do you think your relationship with your mom would be different if you wouldn't have had daughters or children in general?
Or do yes.
you think? Do you?
Yes. Yes, I do. I really do. I mean, the one thing though, no, I think it would be less rich. I think I would understand her much less. The one thing though is I did have cancer at a very young age, and it was a bad case, and it took me like 2 years to get rid of it. And she was incredible. And because my kids were 1 and 2 at the time, it gave her like a real foothold in our family, and she has a lot of confidence with my kids, and they know her very well. And that probably wouldn't happen because she lives in Philadelphia and she doesn't really like to fly, and it's also very expensive. And but during that time that I was sick, she was just in our house a lot. And you know, she came out of retirement. She got to be an active duty mother again for her grown kid. And I remember thinking like, this is a pivot point for us. You know, we'll never go back now. Now I know. Now I know you love me. You can't deny it anymore, lady. Because look where you are.
Right back here.
What do you like to read?
Well, on the nonfiction side, I love Mary Carr. Like the people who do what I do, I like Mary Carr. I love Calvin Trillin. Have you read About Alice? It's just like the most perfect little book, right? It's just a heavenly little book about Alice. Go buy that. And then on the fiction side, I like Marilynne Robinson a lot. Do you know her? She wrote Gilead. So she's just brilliant beyond brilliant. And I think Gilead's almost perfect. I mean, I actually don't know anything that's wrong with it, so it may be a perfect book. And then I hesitate to say, because I don't always know how to say his last name, but I like Gary Steingart, who just wrote Little Failure, but he also wrote Super Sad True Love Story and Absurdistan, and he's really whip smart. And I'm having the best time reading this book right now called The Imperfectionist by Tom Rackman, which I missed, but it was on every single top 10 list in 2011, but I totally slept through it, and it's awesome. So, you know, there's just no end to the number of great things to read out there. And you know, I really like to read poetry sometimes. Like sometimes when I'm stuck, I count reading as writing. So whoever was asking about my process, like a go-to thing for me is if I feel like I can't do anything else, then I just go read. And that counts for me in terms of the way I evaluate my productivity that day. And sometimes I read poetry like Mary Oliver or Derek Walcott or whatever's in The New Yorker or Billy Collins, the great Billy Collins. And that sometimes can like loosen things up for me or, you know, it's just so dense. Like you can get so much in such a little, just a few, you know, a few lines can really open up an idea.
A couple more questions. I've owe you. You've been waiting.
The two parts that kind of suck the air out of my lungs in the book are the one where you talk about your mother feeling too much.
Yeah.
And then the part about when you're playing chess and when you lose the queen, it changes the whole game.
Yeah. No.
Because I would want to know everything she thought about those two sentences.
I know. I know. You know what's so funny is there are things that I've said to my mother in this book that this is literally the only way I could get them across the table to her. I could never say these things out loud. I couldn't put them in a letter. I can only write them in a book and put it on the bestseller list and hope that she's one of the people who reads it. You know, like, it's amazing to me that I was able to, like, get the smoke signal out. And I'll never know what, although I will say this is really funny. With the middle play, you know, they give you something called an ARE, an Advanced Reader Edition, and they send it to Rich and other people in the media to, and probably the folks, Jill, who runs this, like, to try to get some mojo going around your book. And so when I got the middle place, I got two copies. So I kept one, and I sent one to my parents. So fast forward 2 years, I'm in Villanova, where I grew up, and I just done a reading, and I go upstairs, and I get in my mom's bed, because she's the only one who has a good mattress at Wooded Lane, and I put my head on the pillow, and there it is. There's the ARE from 2 years ago, and it has all these dog-eared pages. And I think, oh my God, I am finally gonna find out what you really thought of this book. And my heart's like beating in my ears, and I'm opening it, and I'm looking through. And there's this one page where I say that my the weekend before I started chemo, that my dad was there and we were drinking wine and he opened another bottle without even asking if anyone wanted more. And in the margin, she had done math. So there were four people drinking wine. And if they, and they're about four glasses per bottle. I was like, wow, Ma, you were really swept up in the emotion of that scene. I mean, really. Then at one point she said to me about the middle place, it's very well written. I mean, I didn't catch a single grammatical error. I was going for, Ma.
You told me with this book she only had one change, is that Sissy Zabel said something and it wasn't really, it was somebody else or something.
Yeah, that's right. She has this friend named Sissy Zabel who's it's like a go-to name for me because I just love the sound of Sissy Zabel. And so I think I am over-attributing things to Sissy Zabel. And so the one change, she's, I do have a change. That wasn't Sissy Zabel, that was Marianne Bailey. And I was like, well, I will fix that. But now we'll never have that conversation. Ever. I really don't think. It's a lot. This is a lot of emotion for her.
Okay, two more. I see you two, and we'll go right here, then we'll go right over here.
I was just wondering, with the next generation and how your mom helped out with your family, is she glue for your kids, or is she a bit glitterish? Or
she's like, she's just like a big, warm blanket. Like, she's just so mushy and lovey-dovey, and she has all these, she's a little quirky. She's still her quirky self. Like, she has this is the funniest little thing, but I love it. So she has the kitchen fairy, and the kitchen fairy, like, puts things around the kitchen at night, and she's found all these strange places to put it. So when you open her fridge, it's one of those things where it just has, like, a little divot in the door, you know, and then you put your fingers in and pull it out. Do you know what I'm talking about? And so, every morning when they're at Wood Lane, there's something in the divot, like a little candy or whatever. And then they'll come down and she'll say, oh, I wonder if the kitchen fairy is in here. And then when they pick us up from the airport, my dad comes to pick us up, although I bet that will stop happening and she'll start doing it. He's a little bit of a lead foot. She has her eyeglass cases, and she just, like, pours M&Ms in there, and she puts them in the door thingies. And so then we call. As soon as he collects us, then he says, oh, love it, you gotta call your mother. And then we call her on the speakerphone, and we all talk at once, and nobody can hear each other. And then she says to the girls, I think the eyeglass fairy came. And then they dig around and dig around until they get their M&Ms. So, like, that's the kind of grandma she is.
All right, last question, I think, was right over here.
Hi. and thank you so much. I want to tell you my mother's name. She's not with us anymore. Her name is Anne Elizabeth Wycart Bauer, and I'm an Irish Catholic descendant. She had 9 children. Huh. And so I've really related to so
that,
much
like,
about...
That, like, instantly made my lady parts clamp shut when you said that.
She was so laid back, though. It was really cool. But I related to so much of what you said. But what I really want to say to you is to give you encouragement about this time of your life with your girls. I have 3 babies that are now 38, 34, and 23. And they've come around. You know, they're humans again, and it's so cool. And it's really
so how
worth
long would you
it.
Say I have to wait? Like, well, is it 10 years? Or?
Okay, well, with girls, and I have 2 girls and a boy. The boy is 23. He was the slowest one. And truly, he's only been gone for
as
a
I
year
said
and
earlier,
a half.
The smarter sex.
But the girls, I mean, the girls, and, you know, with they both live in different states with video chatting and iPhones and, you know, texting and everything, and the grandbabies on the video chat. It's really been wonderful. So they come back. My one came back from U of M after a year and said, "Look at this house." And my husband said,
"Who are you?"
She's back. You know, like the kid before she was 15 or 13. So good luck. It'll be fine.
I think we'll know when your daughter comes home from wherever and talks to you like this, and she's doing your voice now.
She's going to have so many great chapters for her memoir.
Well, Kelly, thank you so much for talking to us about
Total pleasure.
It's so wonderful
Total
to have
pleasure.
You. Thank you.
Such a pleasure.